Proprietary blends. Are they useful in the supplement industry, or should they no longer exist? If you mention proprietary blends or prop blends in the supplement social groups, and these social groups are made up of like the 0.1% of educated or I guess like passionate consumers and then industry professionals, you tend to get this visceral reaction in these groups, and it's very much skewed towards the negative impression of prop blends. So for me, I'm kind of neutral in this argument, and that's mostly because I work in a variety of different consumer packaged goods categories, and in any of these other CPG categories, a proprietary blend is essentially a trade secret. It is something very much a positive thing. Do you know what goes into your Coca-Cola? What about your Oreo cookies? Ben & Jerry's ice cream, Revlon foundation, Old Spice body wash. You know the ingredient list, but you have no understanding of how many grams, how many milliliters, you know, whatever it is, you have no idea. And that formula, that proprietary blend formula, is a trade secret. And those are a main part of why I just named billion-dollar brands. So which side is right? Should prop blends in supplements exist, or should they just go away? So to add some information or just kind of look at this maybe a little bit differently than you already do, if you have a strong visceral reaction to the idea of prop blends in nutritional supplements, I'm going to be trying to look at this both from like the consumer side, I'm trying to look at it from the business side. I'm going to pick five maybe areas that will help form an opinion for you. So number one, this idea of like an intent of purchase. So from a consumer standpoint, I mean, I understand that the vitamins, mineral supplements, nutritional supplement type of section is very different than most of the other consumer packaged goods categories. There's this inherent intent behind the purchase that's deeper than trying to just satiate one of the lowest like Maslow hierarchy of needs because you're hungry or you're thirsty. You're essentially buying a product because you're attempting to reach a goal, be that something health related or be that something like look related. You have some idea of maybe wanting to transform your body in some way to feel better about yourself. And you're buying those products because they claim to be able to improve your ability to meet one of those goals. So if you think about that on a spectrum, supplements are probably closer to pharmaceuticals than they are to maybe a tasty cookie or ice cream. So due to that, I understand the interest of wanting to have full transparency in the product and not having a formula be hidden in a proprietary blend. The industry, the brands, a part of the supplement industry are fully aware of the intent behind a lot of the purchasing that happens in the category. That interest, that continued growth and interest to be healthier and in a vanity aspect of it, does drive the growth in the industry. It drives a lot of the innovation, a lot of the good parts of the industry, but it also drives a lot of the malicious type of shady practices or products that, you know, have marketing claim to hide some of the pixie dusting that happens in a proprietary blend. Let's look at like a second area here about purchase behavior, because I think that's important to kind of look at here. So from a consumer, if you just look at some of the purchase behavior of the consumers in the category, and you look at some of the kind of sections that have maybe the most notorious proprietary blend products being like a pre-workout or fat burner or like a test booster, you'll see that most of the top sellers, and I'm talking about ones that have, you know, across all sales channels, I'm not looking at one little specific sales channel, you know, the biggest products in the industry in those categories, a lot of them have some aspect of proprietary blend, either it's fully proprietary or it has some aspect of proprietary, maybe with an energy matrix or something that is hidden from the consumer. So as a business owner, as a person that is a part of the business side of the industry, if you see that market activity, you see that purchase behavior, and it's pointing towards, you know, the biggest products in the industry are still hidden some aspect of their formula behind a proprietary blend, it doesn't incentivize you to change your ways. But I think it's important to kind of take this one step further and kind of discuss maybe why the consumers are still purchasing those products. And this is the third point I want to bring up, and this is the idea of asymmetric knowledge. And I say asymmetric knowledge, but honestly, it's more laziness than anything. And I used the word asymmetric knowledge, but in today's world, there's no really such thing as that outside of maybe some very intricate ideas, concepts, knowledge, professions. The information, all information is disseminated fully on the internet. You have the ability to learn anything at any degree that you would like to learn. So if you are a consumer in a nutritional supplement category, you have all the information available to you to understand what is a good product, bad product, what should you be forming your purchase criteria around, what do you need, what do you not need, to meet the intent that you are seeking these products for. But you tend not to get this information seeking from consumers is because it's a science subject. It's around science. Just like I work a lot with finance and numbers, it's the same thing. You would tune into CNBC, or honestly, sometimes maybe when you watch me, you might just tune out because I'm talking about math, numbers, equations, things that you're like, over my head, I don't want to think about this. And that's what happens. You tend to then convert back to like an easier decision-making tree. You move to something that you can easily decipher and make a decision on. So that's usually around maybe like, what feeling do I get when I take this product? Is there a sensory aspect to it? Do I feel like it's working? So the business side, and not all brand owners, businesses do this, but they understand that as well. They know that there's just a disinterest in getting the knowledge that you need to maybe make the most appropriate buying decision. So because there's this aspect of the sensory part of it, you can create products that have a high amount of, you know, sensory effect. And most of those ingredients, you know, stimulants or something like a niacin that creates feeling in your body, those are pretty cheap ingredients comparable to a lot of other things that maybe don't have a sensory ingredient but are more important to a product. So this is part of the issue in terms of proprietary blends and being able to hide things in a prop blend, underdose products, because if you understand that you can hide a lot of the more expensive ingredients that don't have sensory effects in a proprietary blend, just to make sure it's on the label, or have a pixie dusting, again, element to this so you can make sure you can make claims in your marketing. This is where things start to break down and why people get upset. And this kind of leads into the fourth element that I want to talk about, just like market sentiment. So from the consumer standpoint, and I'm talking just any available consumers, not just ones that currently buy supplements, I'm talking about just the whole available adult market that could potentially buy vitamins, minerals, and supplements. And most of the mass media, the media that gets the most amount of eyeballs, tend to paint the industry in not the best picture. They tend to speak about the negative aspects of it. They don't speak a lot about the positive aspects of it. So there's a general market sentiment of maybe that brand owners are snake oil salesmen. They are just doing things inappropriately. There's not any regulations. There's just a ton of things that potentially hurt the industry. And I won't go into, you know, just all the variables that go into this. It's too complex for anybody to really understand all the ins and outs that go into the market sentiment. And I'm not saying that proprietary blends are a major part of that or a major part of fixing it, but I do believe it's an element that could create a positive impact to market sentiment. And from a business perspective, you look at just the industry as a whole and you see, you know, a very good growing, fast growing compounded annual growth rate. You say the industry is growing. This is great. Again, the incentive is not all that high for you to kind of change your methodologies, change the way you do business. But think about if maybe the market sentiment wasn't as negative as it is. Like, what potentially could the growth rate be? Like, how much bigger could the industry be growing if there was a much more positive market sentiment? And this opens up a whole different area of discussion around regulations and what we could do and couldn't do to improve it and all the ins and outs, things I was talking about before. I have made a video a little bit about my thoughts on just self-regulation on the industry. I'll make one of these kind of pop-ups. If you guys were interested in that, you guys can watch that video. This video is really not for that. But I do want to kind of transition to the last point, the last variable that I want to bring up is just around this idea of future trends. From the consumer standpoint, we touched on this right at the beginning of the video. I talked about how the 0.1% of consumers, you know, the very passionate consumers, the what you want to consider maybe like the bleeding edge, first adopter part of the industry, and the professionals that work within the industry, you know, they're talking about transparency. They're talking about the need for having transparent products, not hiding behind proprietary blends, cleaning up the industry, wanting to make sure that there's properly dosed products that are open label, are transparent on the label, so the consumer understands exactly what they're getting for their money. And I think there's another element that's in place here. If you think about maybe another side of it from the consumer standpoint, is you have a lot of lifestyle consumers coming into the market. These are new consumers that maybe don't have a established expectation with vitamins, minerals, supplements, and they might not be as educated in the early stages. They're going to need to have a lot more education to get them to the point of maybe this passionate first adopter type of consumer. And they're also attaching themselves to, you know, more food, beverage, on-the-go convenience type items that are more lifestyle, more able to add into their just day-to-day, not, you know, caps, powders, pills, a lot of the legacy businesses. So if we think about those two kind of future indicators of trends, from the business perspective, you have this idea of, you know, depending, this is obviously dependent on the particular brand, the particular business, like where are they positioned in the market for sales channels and product-wise, what's their value as a part of their brand. You know, they might not have any short-term incentive to change because of that reason, because they know they're going to be, you know, in food, drug, mass convenience, where maybe the consumer's not as educated as digital or as maybe some of specialty retail buyers, so don't have any incentive there to change. Even if you do start to see some momentum going in those sales channels, if you already are selling in some of those food, drug, mass convenience sales channels, odds are you are already offering or starting to offer, you know, functional food, functional drink type of protein bar, single serving energy drinks and food. And that kind of falls in line with more of what I was talking about at the beginning with trade secrets and hiding behind, you know, formulas and ingredient lists, creating proprietary blends essentially. So it creates this kind of cycle that could happen again. Now, if your brand is positioned more towards the premium, more towards a better educated consumer side of the industry, you should be making some of these changes if you haven't already. I'm assuming that you're well aware of knowing to make the changes of transparent labels and not hiding behind proprietary blends. Pose this question one more time. So should proprietary blends be around today or no? So here's my raw answer. Here's my opinion on the matter. It might trigger some people. It might also make people think that I'm copping out of this, but this is just my kind of thoughts. Is that the market currently has all the available information that they could need to make informed decisions and form their own purchase criteria that creates winners and losers in the market. The market provides a variety of different options at a variety of different price points, some proprietary blends, some transparent. So the market will ultimately decide if this is a good thing or a bad thing based around how much money they spend towards those categories and what trends evolve based around some of that purchasing behavior. So my opinion is the market opinion's way more important than my opinion. And I might have my own purchase criteria, but it's just one person in a much bigger pool. So I believe in the market. I believe in the market's ability to decide winners and losers. So proprietary blends at this point, they're going to stick around. How long they stick around, I'm not sure. But to leave this topic here, if you guys have opinions on proprietary blends, I would love to hear those down in the comments. How long you guys think they'll be around for, maybe what your thoughts are around proprietary blends. If you hate them, why do you hate them? If you love them, why do you love them?
Thank you so much for watching this video. If you want to help support me, make sure you guys hit that thumbs up button on this video. If this is the first time you've been introduced to my videos, would love for you guys to be a part of my community by subscribing to my channel. I upload several videos just like this weekly. And if you guys want to connect further outside of this platform, I do include all of my social media links down below. I just want to thank you guys again for your time. Hopefully I gave you some value in return, and we'll see you guys on the next video.